Alright, this is John Cullough with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm coming at you from my backyard garden, and this is a very important episode I've been wanting to make for a while. I have so many ideas on episodes I could make, but have very little time, as most of you guys do. You guys always complain, John, I don't have time to watch your videos, man. They're like 60 minutes long. Maybe if you made one like 15 minutes, I'd watch it. So I'm going to do the best I can to make this video like 15 minutes or less for you guys that don't like my long videos. That being said, the topic of this video is time. How do you save time? I'll tell you how you guys can save time watching my videos. In the corner, I think it's over there or over there, I don't know what side this is going on, but there's a little spoke. You can click that spoke and watch my videos at 2x speed, so I talk twice as fast. So if my hour video, poof, instantly turns into 30 minutes of video. My half hour video now turns into 15 minutes of video, provided that you can understand when I'm talking really quick. And it's not that hard to difficult to understand if I'm talking quick, and especially if you guys are from New York, you guys should have no problem whatsoever. All right, so. In any case, this episode is an episode dedicated to saving you guys time, not only on my videos, which I just shared, but also in the garden. That's something very important to me, right? I grow lots of things. I do many things in my life. Gardening and growing food is just one of them. I have YouTube channels I make videos for all the time. I make my juice. I prepare my food from scratch. I run a business. And I don't have a lot of time to be out in my garden. That being said, you know, my gardening time is kind of like my meditation or relaxation time. I just get out in nature and just zone out and just get to play with my plants, literally, and it's really cool. But that being said, there's many things in gardening that you guys don't have to spend the time for that you could save time by automating things, by doing things a little bit differently. You know, and that's what I'm going to share with you guys in this episode. Some of the tips and things that I've learned over the years to save myself time, but share with you guys so you guys could save time too. So let's go ahead and get started. So my first tip on saving time is to automate things, especially your irrigation system. I know many of you guys might still be manually watering your plants, going out every night, spending a half hour, 2 hours, whatever it takes to water your plants, right? I mean, come on, guys, this is the 2017 or 2000s, whatever, and there's automated systems and things that can save you guys time. Lots of different tools and gardening tools and, you know, advances in watering systems besides just like a hose or besides carrying buckets from the stream or your rain gutters to water your plants. There's automatic irrigation systems, whatever kind you guys choose to use. You know, over on this side of my yard, I have the drip system. Over the other, on the other side of the yard, I have the subsoil aqua jet irrigation system. Whatever you guys choose, that's going to save you guys a lot of time. Once you have it set all up properly, right, you don't have to come out and water each and every day. And as the seasons change, you know, I scale back and change my watering cycles, which is really simple to do. I could log in on my computer anywhere in the world and change my watering cycles, and you know, I don't have to be here to water. So besides saving time, it allows me the freedom to do what I need to do when I need to do and not have to worry that my plants won't get water and lose their lives. My second tip for saving time is to start from transplants whenever you're able and you have the time to do so, right? Instead of buying like or replanting my garlic cloves from last year, which I will be planting some of those, I like to always have a jump on the season. So I like to buy the transplants. So these transplants, right? Somebody planted up the little cloves of garlic, and now I have nice sized plants that I could literally just, you know, divide out, separate, and pop into my garden. So my garlic will get that much bigger and be earlier that much sooner, you know, at the end of the season. And this goes for any plant. You know, the problem with buying transplants is that they can be expensive. But it's gonna save you guys time, headaches, and worries. You know, it can be very challenging from the time a seed germinates to take care of it so that it grows into a healthy plant. And I know a lot of new gardeners have challenges sprouting their seeds and getting them going. They get leggy plants because maybe they don't have enough light, or maybe they got the wrong soil mixture, the stuff molds, it never germinates, they don't have the right temperatures. So many things can go wrong, and that's why I recommend starting out with some good healthy transplants. You know, if you're in Southern California, I recommend CPG Nursery. I buy things by the flat down there. Put a link down below if I remember. You know, they're a good affordable source of transplants. You guys could get growing earlier, healthier, and be eaten sooner. Third way to be more efficient, save time in the garden, is instead of using a standard trowel to like dig a hole and plant in your transplants, you know, do something that's actually better for the soil life because you're disturbing the soil less. You know, when you're using a big trowel, you can't ever get like that right precise hole, you know, to plant your transplant. So what I like to use instead is just a simple bulb planter. I think I picked this up for a dollar like on clearance or something at the end of the season. But basically I just use this bulb planter, go in and core a little piece out, dump this, you know, the soil that I take out on top. I got my six pack here. We got some edible violas, and we just basically take a transplant, pop it in the right, we make it the right depth, and we just put some of that soil around, and poof. I mean, I'm done transplanting ever so quick and easy, and this definitely saves me lots of time when I'm planting out 36 plants per bed, or 72 plants per bed, or 80 plants behind the camera that you guys can't see of peppers. Using that ball planter saves me lots of time. Also, reduces the tillage and digging that I'm doing in the soil. Tip number four is grow low maintenance crops, right? If you grow low maintenance crops, literally, as long as you got an irrigation system, you pretty much don't have to do anything because the bugs and pests don't bother them. And you're gonna have to learn for yourself what are more low maintenance crops in your specific climate and area, depending on the pest pressures and the diseases in your area and whatnot, you know? I found that a reliable, plant for me to grow is the rosemary. I mean, literally this guy, I got him as a 4-inch, pot. I planted him, and years later, you know, the problem with the rosemary is that there's too much of it and I need to be trimming it more. But other than that, I pay no attention to it. I don't do anything, and I have instant food to eat year round. So I want you guys to find some of the more lower maintenance crops that don't tend to have pest pressures. You know, herbs are an excellent start. All the essential oils in the herbs are basically there for anti-disease and anti-pests, right? So yeah, grow some herbs, grow some rosemary, and grow other disease and pest resistant plants where you live. So my fifth tip is to grow some perennial vegetables, right? Depending on your region, perennial vegetables will vary. But perennial vegetables are really cool vegetables because literally you plant them once and they can last a lifetime, right? Whether it's like my tree collards here that are now, you know, pushing 5 feet tall. I planted them actually end of the winter, I believe, last year. They grew all throughout the summer and they're just going to keep thriving throughout the cold winter. And actually that's when the leaves get a lot sweeter. They're going to grow a lot taller and they just keep producing leaves for me day after day, year after year. Unlike growing a standard kale or something like that, that you got to replant, that'll bolt and go to flower, set seed, it'll stop production. These guys keep growing. And there are many other perennial vegetables you guys could grow. You know, your cone, Jerusalem artichokes, you know, Egyptian walking onions, some other ones that do good here, horseradish, the red vein sorrel, you know, oh, cactus, you know, don't forget about the cactus here in the desert. You know, they just grow year round. You can harvest the pads and eat them. They are a vegetable, matter of fact. But yeah, find out the perennial vegetables near you. And I have other episodes. I'll put a link down below to an episode, if I remember, for a good episode on perennial vegetables that you may be able to grow near you. But yeah, plant them once and forget about them. So I don't have to like till this bed. I don't have to really do much to this bed or replant things. I basically just top it off with compost every season. And basically let all these guys keep growing. Tip number six is grow some wild edible vegetables or wild foods and rambunctious vegetables that will literally reseed on their own, right? This bed here is pretty much, except for the tree collards in the middle, I didn't plant out. Nature did my work for me and I just got to reap the rewards or reap the food off of it. And I'm grateful for that. So. What we got in here is on the bottom, we got dandelions, which are known as a wild food. They're also kind of cultivated, but these are wild dandelions that just kind of blew in and I've been letting them grow in certain areas of my yard, and I could come out, harvest the dandelion roots, which are quite healthy, or the leaves. And then also on the top here, we got one of my favorites. I planted this guy like a couple years ago, and this is the purple variety of shiso. And I love the deep purple pigments for the antioxidants. And basically they just go to seed. The seeds fly over my garden. Once the plants are done, I'll just this guy's done. I'll take this and shake it out in areas and I'll distribute the seeds in certain areas I want it to grow for next year. And when the time and weather is right, they sprout up on their own so that I don't have to worry about starting my shiso seeds indoors, starting my transplants. I literally just put the seeds where they need to be and they come up on their own. right? And I'm sure in your area you will find the plants that will reseed on their own. I mean, just the other day I found a lettuce plant and actually some kind of brassica plant that came up on its own. You know, I often get tree collards when I try to collect most of the seeds, but I do let some drop, and I get these really cool varieties of tree collards that are not 100% true come up, right? And these are some of the easy things to grow so that you don't have to, like, go in and start the seeds and transplant and all this kind of stuff. Let nature do the work for you and save you guys lots of time. Seventh tip to save you guys time is regarding compost, right? I want to make sure all you guys are composting if you have the extra space to do so. I use space in an alleyway that I really couldn't grow any substantial amount of food, but I compost all the food waste and all the compostable waste out of my gardens. And, you know, compost is integral with gardening, and I believe more gardeners should be composting, you know, to make the best soil on the planet. You know, the soil that you could make, not soil that you buy. But anyways, with composting, the number one key to saving time with composting is aeration. So I want you guys to flip that pile. I visit so many people's farms and gardens and places where they're trying to compost, and, you know, I see stagnant piles that aren't being flipped, that aren't being aerated. And when you don't aerate the pile, guess what? Compost takes significantly longer, right? I mean, if I aerate this pile, and since I got compost tumblers, we could just spin the tumblers, and I'll put a link down below to my favorite tumbler, which is the jar form. You could check it out. You know, spinning the tumblers, simply aerating it for me. I could do it quickly and easily. That aerates my pile, and in my jar form, I could have compost literally in 1 month, which is really quickly. You know, if I didn't turn it every day, or like I'm supposed to be doing, you know, it could take 2 or 3 months, because it's going to take a lot longer for that to break down. And don't forget, you can even automate your aeration process, like we saw a couple episodes ago. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to the Charman's episode, where he basically ran like a blower fan underneath this compost pile with perforated pipes that was on a timer that came on a few minutes every day to aerate his pile so that he could make compost quicker, save him time, and cycle the nutrients back into his garden that much sooner. Fresh goji berries galore. Look at all these guys, man. I have tons of these goji berries. I could just be sitting here and eating. But yeah, goji berries, that's another good low maintenance crop. Grow here in the desert. But this tip is actually before you even start to plant your garden out, or for the new season even, or if you're a new gardener, right? I want you guys to take the time to visit your local farms, gardens, community gardens, farmers markets, and talk to people. And find out what crops people have easier times growing and are more successful with. You know, when I moved here, I went around and talked to some of the gardening experts in the area and even made videos with them to find out what they're growing and, more importantly, how they're doing it. This can save you ample and tons of time from going to the school of hard knocks and trying to grow things that won't really grow too well in your environment. That being said, once you're up and growing, I do encourage you guys to always experiment and push the envelope and try to grow things that maybe the experts said you couldn't grow. But start off, for sure, 90% of your garden should be stuff that you know is going to grow well, so you could have that pride of growership. Another really good resource for you guys is check out your university extension office and master gardeners in your area. They generally will put out flyers or guidelines or something like that. And to tell you guys what will do well in your area. I mean, they've researched all this stuff, so you guys don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can learn from their mistakes and just grow what works. Tip number 9 is a very important tip for you guys. I want you guys to be growing in good quality soil. You know, compost, locally sourced compost, and other soil mixtures you guys can get locally near you. I can't really go into details on getting a good soil mixture in this episode because that's actually quite a complex topic, and I can't just say do this or something because every geographic area is a little bit different. But I like to encourage you guys to seek out bulk soil suppliers, and before buying any large quantities is to get a little small sample and do pot tests where you actually, you know, get soil from different companies and test those growing the same identical plants and see which soil the plants respond better to and grow better and faster in. You know, aside from getting good soil, and the soil that I'd recommend if you guys can't find any good stuff near you is the bag soil. A lot of bag soil is crap, but at least the Dr. Earth has a fairly consistent product, and they're one of the best bag soil products out there that I've found, and I've played with many of them. So So the Dr. Earth's pot of gold, the one I use actually to fill some of my raised beds here in my backyard. And of course, aside from having good soil, you want to amend that soil to have some really key nutrients in there. You know, I go into many videos where I talk about this in detail, but I'm going to keep it short this time. We're going to talk about worm gold plus worm castings or other kinds of worm castings, high quality worm castings. Not all worm castings are created equal. Worm gold plus is my second favorite, kind of like the OGS, organic garden solution. Castings is my number one favorite kind, but they're actually really hard to get. And then of course you got to add something like the trace minerals. Like over here we got the azomite, which is a kind of a, what I consider a rock dust. Basically this adds up to A to Z of minerals, up to 70 different trace minerals in the rock dust. The worm castings basically give the minerals the fire, because they have the microbes and the beneficial fungi and microbes that help break down those rock dust nutrients and make them available for the plants. And this feeds the whole complex food soil web. But yeah, if you don't remember anything else, make sure you get good soil for faster growing crops that you'll be able to enjoy sooner, and they're gonna grow larger for you. Tip number 10 is a very important tip that many gardeners may forget about, because we're so focused on our planting beds and our growing beds and things that we're growing and all this kind of stuff, right? And what I want to recommend for you guys is, in your walkways, don't forget to use wood chip mulch, right? Or some kind of mulch in the ground to cover it. Maybe you have to do sheet mulching with cardboard and then put on the wood chips over the top, right? What'll this do? Well, this will save you guys lots of time, headaches, and hassle from weeding and pulling up weeds that are coming up in your garden, right? If you don't do some kind of mulching, maybe grasses will grow or other weeds will come, bindweeds and all these kind of crazy things, and you're gonna have to spend more time maintaining your garden when you should just be able to come and stroll down your garden, right? Also, I really like that this area is wood chipped now, and these are wood chips actually I created on site when I took a couple trees down. This area does not get muddy when it rains in the winter time. And in addition, aside from that, now I'm using my space wisely, because now when the wood chips break down after a couple years, I'll go underneath and collect the stuff on the bottom, and I'm always topping these guys off. I'm gonna have some nice fungal dominated compost to actually add in to my soil blends that I grow food in. So yeah, mulching gonna save you time, because you will not have to be weeding, and that's another reason why I like the raised bed so much, right? I fill this up with weed-free soil mixes, weed seed free soil mixes, and literally I have very little weeds. About the only weeds that I get are ones that like birds come in and, you know, drop their poop, which have some seeds in it, or maybe there's a random seed that makes it through my composting system and I have, you know, something come up. But in many cases it's a food, and I don't consider that a weed. I just consider it something to eat. So yeah, mulch your pathways, create more fertility on your land, and save you guys time. So my 11th and final tip for you guys to save time when gardening is to grow fast turn crops. You know, even if you're not in production and you're trying to like grow food as fast as you can to sell it to make money at a farmer's market, for us home gardeners, that's also very important, so that you could start some seeds, start growing something, and have food to eat sooner rather than later, so that you could actually be producing more food for you and your family. Of course, if you're growing indoors, like many of you guys may be doing this time of year, I do encourage you guys to grow sprouts and microgreens. Sprouts and microgreens, they could be ready in as soon as a day for some of the sprouts, or 2 days, 3 days. You know, I sprout buckwheat in nice climatic warm conditions in 1 day, just for the hulled kind with no greens. But, microgreens can be done in 10 days, 7 to 10 days, depending on what seed you're using. And you could produce a lot of food in very little time using that method, so that you could be eating out of your garden instead of having to wait and plant some kale that might take 30 days to harvest, you know? If you are planting outside, there are crops that you guys could grow outside to get more immediate gratification, and we live in an immediate gratification society these days, such as radishes, or here I have arugula, another really nice fast grower. I mean, this guy's off to the races, literally. I come out every night or every other night and pinch off a leaf, and it seems like by the next day that leaf is filled in and there's a new leaf taking its place. So I could literally have an endless supply of the greens in my garden to eat from. Another crop that's very fast grower is the mustard greens, right? Some of these brassica family plants, you know, are very health promoting and good for seed, and also they're really fast growers. Of course, also there are some edible kind of weeds that are also very fast growers that you might want to look into, that are actually really easy to grow, because you don't really have to do much. You just got to throw out the seeds and wait for them to come in and harvest. So that's pretty much the end of this episode today. Hopefully it wasn't too long for a lot of you guys. Hopefully you guys watched it so you guys could save more time in your garden, right? I have so many projects, so many things to do. Sometimes I just have wild beds because I haven't taken care of it and I just let food grow for me instead of me having to manage it. I want you guys to do some of these tips that I've shared in this video for you guys so you guys could save time and have food that you're growing sooner rather than later. Also, please, hey, post your tips down below on saving time so that other people can benefit from your knowledge, and I'll read the comments and maybe I'll learn something new and you'll help me save more time so I could do all these crazy things that I do in my life. If you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up to let me know. That'll encourage me to do more episodes like this in the future. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes I'm coming out of every 3 to 4 days on this YouTube channel. You never know what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,300 episodes at this time, teach you guys all aspects on how you guys can grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.